our days in this present world, Paul says, the times, the dispensation, okay, are wicked. The days are evil. Evil because there is no knowledge of God. Okay, that this world that we live in does not know God. And we've always said that knowing God goes beyond the superficial mentioning of the name of God. Everybody calls God, God, God. Everybody says Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Even Satan says Jesus. See, knowing God comes by experience. It's a personal awareness, okay, that starts from the inner being, okay, whereby we actually come to a place where we say we know God. And if you have known God, you have known the one, him that is from the beginning, like John, we say, that is the apostle, say, those of you who have known him that is from the beginning. So, in this present dispensation, there is no knowledge of God. Everything is lost. All men have fallen short of the glory of God. Now, not some, but all men in their humanity have fallen short of the glory of God. You can also equate that to mean that there is no knowledge of God in this present world. When Paul says that I may know him, he's speaking about an experience, that I may actually experience God by ascension, by resurrection, by increase in him. Every man must transcend that human state to get back to knowing him that is from the beginning. Okay, today we are going to share on the new song. And the new song is actually a song that has been from the beginning. There's nothing new under the sun. Just bear this in mind. It can only become new because you forgot it, or you lost awareness of it. So we now call it a new song. Hear of a new name, you shall get a new name, you shall be rewarded with a new name. That new name is actually a name that has been from the beginning. So if you are going to sing a new song, like the 144,000 standing upon Mount Zion, okay, this is the number of the redeemed. It's a symbolic number. Okay, in the realm of God, you don't have numbers. There's nothing like numbers in God's kingdom. Okay, but it's a symbolic number, 12 times 12. With the three zeros, it just talks about people that have grown into the full stature of the Son of God. Okay, if you read through the book of Revelation 14, you see this 144 standing, this 144,000 Okay, who were standing with the lamp upon Mount Zion. And it says they have the name of the Father written on their foreheads. Okay, now these are people who have ascended on high. They have been redeemed. Now I'm going to read this a couple of verses here so that we just have the whole picture of what we are sharing. And I heard a voice from heaven that sounded like a roaring waterfall, like a loud peal of thunder. It sounded like music made by musicians playing their harps. The 144,000 people stood before the throne, the four living creatures and the elders, and they were singing a new song which only they could learn. Of the human race, they are the only ones who have been redeemed. They are the men who have kept themselves pure by not having sexual relations with women. They are virgins. They follow the Lamb wherever it goes. They have been redeemed from the rest of the human race and are the first ones to be offered to God and to the lambs. They have never been known to tell lies, and they are faultless. Now, this is something I just read. I used the Good News Version. They speak in very, very simple terms. Yeah, it speaks about 144,000 people who are redeemed from the earth, redeemed from among men. Okay, and this is a wonderful spectacle, because standing upon Mount Zion means standing at the pinnacle of creation in God, because Mount Zion is actually the holy spot where God is found, and being a holy spot, there is nothing that can actually find its way, you know, upon Mount Zion except God. Hence, you have these people here bearing the Father's name. Now, this is the highest state of consciousness and their highest state of being. They stand in the Father's name. Okay, these are the ones who have resurrected and transcended humanity. They've been taken away from men. They've been taken away from among men. They are no longer classified in the genealogy of men, but in God. They have been redeemed from among men, okay, and stand upon Mount Zion. These are the ones that have the new name, which is the Father's name. Okay, they have now known God. They have now known the Father. Like I said, this comes by experience, not by any superficial, you know, mentioning of names and all that. It comes by experience. Knowing God comes by experience. Okay, you experience God, that God is my life, and that is the Father's name written upon the foreheads. This is the new name, the new identity. It is no longer I, but the Lord that lives. Now, there's something I just want us to observe, that these people here, they sing a new song which no one could learn, because we must understand that this is not just a song that you learn and you kind of you a new song that you learn and sing in church on Sundays. Okay, we're talking of a spiritual communication deep unto deep. This is a song that has actually been sung even before time. Okay, Job, you know, these things are mentioned right from the book of Job. Now, Job was written, okay, the story of Job was written thousands of years before John had the revelation, you know, upon the, you know, while he was on the island of Patmos. So what we are seeing here, we're seeing, you know, something mystical that is happening here. God is showing us a revelation. Remember the story of Job. Job was somebody who had all the sicknesses, all the misfortune. He lost his wealth, he lost his family, he lost his health. You know, he lost everything in this is human, you know, sense of life. And you can consider Job as an example of those who suffer great tribulation in this present world. Okay, you know, whether you like it or not, to the extent every single man upon the earth who is living the life absent of God is like Job. Okay, because in that consciousness you are actually miserable, poor, and wretched. No matter how you look outwardly before men, spiritually speaking, you are poor, miserable, and wretched in your humanity. So God, after Job had made all these laments, and you know, his friends came around and they all gave their sermons. Now the friends, you can call the friends the pastors, the counselors, you know, the spiritual gurus, and all, everybody comes with his own idea, you know, about how to get out of your situation in your humanity. Okay, the medical science people come out with their own report. Everybody has his own way, his own, you know, brings out his own solution. But you see, none of the solutions proffered or given by men can ever solve the problem of humanity. Just bear it in mind. The only thing that can solve the problem of humanity is what we're about to hear right now. Because after all said and done, God speaks out of a whirlwind. God speaks out of a whirlwind, out of the spirit. Okay, he speaks out of the whirlwind. Now, this is what happened on the day of Pentecost. You see the wind that comes in, you know? That wind is actually the invisible body of God. God speaks out of the whirlwind. And every man must hear that voice speaking out of the whirlwind. And, you know, the way God faces Job, God does it in a very strange manner. God does not begin to use the approach of men to solve the problem of humanity. Some of us think are getting more cash, okay, getting good families, getting, you know, good everything in this present world will solve the problems of humanity. But you discover at the end of days that some of these things only even, you know, cause you to be more entangled in miserable woes and sorrows. So when God speaks, he speaks to liberate you, he seeks to heal you, and healing is only in God. Perfection is in God. So God speaks out of the storm. God speaks out of the whirlwind. And you know, he begins to ask Job certain questions that even Job could not answer at that point in time. But today we all have the answers by the Spirit. Because the spirit, which is the spirit of God in us, which is the true spirit within us, teaches us all things. Now, he teaches us all things about God, because that is all that is to be learned. He gives us the mystery of God, and he reveals everything plainly to us, so that the parables become, are all explained. The riddles are all explained. The mystery of God is brought to light. It's no longer a mystery, and this is where the healing comes. This is where the our promotion into life comes. So God begins to ask Job, where were you? Where were you, son of man? Where were you when I laid the foundations of this world, when I created this world, when I laid the cornerstone of this world? Where were you, you little ignorant worm? Where were you? Job 38 verse 7 says, in the dawn of that day, the morning stars sang together, okay, and the heavenly beings shouted for joy. That's the Good News version, and I'm going to just let me just go back to the version of St. James, which sounds more, it has a kind of say. It says, where were you when the morning stars stand together and the sons of God shouted for joy? Where were you? Where were you? Okay, and if you go down further, he goes on to ask some other strange questions. Okay, questions that no man could answer in that day. Okay, he asked him, he says, have you seen the springs of the sea? Or has thou walked in the search of the depths? Okay, have the gates of death been opened unto thee? Or hast thou seen the doors of the shadow of death? How hast thou perceived the breadth of the earth? Declare if thou knowest it all. Where is the way where light dwelleth? And as for darkness, where is the place thereof? Now let's pause there. Now it goes on and on for chapters, and God was speaking mysteries, asking Job questions. Now these questions are the questions that the Spirit of God that is waking up within us is bringing to light to us today. These are the things that we get to begin to understand clearly today. We begin to understand where the shadow of death is. We begin to understand the mystery of light, where light is, where, you know, where the gates of death is, where the depths of the sea is, which is the abyss. We begin to understand where we were when the morning stars shouted together for joy. Because that was the question. Say, where were you when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy? Where were you? Now, God wants you to, by the Spirit, remember that you were actually among the morning stars. Now, I don't like to use that word, you were. You are among the morning stars. And you are actually sons of God. The sons of God and the morning stars are interchangeable. It's the same thing. Okay, the morning stars are the angelic structure, angelic beings. Okay, and angels and sons of God are the same things. Those that walk in the resurrection in the ages to come are like angels, being sons of God. Is this, they're the same things. Jesus, the Son of God, was made lower than the angels. Okay, so the angelic state only speaks about your spirituality. Okay, speaks about your spiritual state. Okay, the angels are spirit and the sons of God are actually angels. These things are mentioned subtly throughout the Bible. You see angels, you know, sons of God all over the places. These things are referenced to you and I in the glory of God. Now bear in mind that without the angels or without the sons of God, there is nothing like God. God is actually made, is seen. God is manifested in the congregation of his angels, the assembly of his angels, or the heavenly gathering of angels. There's nothing like God apart, and you know, this is actually a composite body of the eternal spirit of God. We're all in one in him, and it's already present. This is present reality. The only thing is that men are deep asleep. Men walk in the shadow of death. Men walk in the abyss, and in this place the understanding is completely darkened. Men lose all awareness of the fact that they are actually sons of God who have their being in God. Okay, but today we have the key. You see, when God, when you get the ministration, when you get the understanding from above, when the lightning flashes on you, it's like giving you a key to open the gates of hell and death. Okay, you are in your humanity, you're actually dwelling in the abyss, and you're actually dwelling, okay, in the shadow of death. But it comes to pull you out, it comes to give you a key, and the key today is the revelation of the Christ in you. If you can know the truth about yourself, you can loosen yourself out of the grip of mortality, loosen yourself, okay, you know, out of that, you know, sense of separation from God. You can loosen yourself out of that low state and ascend back right now, just by self-recognition, ascend back into your true identity that you are from the beginning, which is that the statue of the Son of God. Okay, the gospel is the key, is the good news. To him that has believed, all you just need to do is to believe what you've heard, and he has given you the power, okay, it has given you the ability, he has enabled you to walk once more as Son of God, as it was from the beginning. So nothing is new in this world. Okay, that song that you sang in the beginning, in the beginning of creation, that song that you sang, you know, among the morning stars, is actually the new song that you are singing today upon Mount Zion. Now this is a song for the living. It's a song that only the living can sing. No man can sing this song. When I talk of men, I'm talking of dead men. Okay? So you hear the song of Bob Marley. Bob Marley says, by the river of Babylon, you know, we could not sing this song. Babylon is the realm where people live in exile, who are alienated from the life of God. It's the realm of the world where there is no knowledge of God. See, but spontaneously, the harps, the string instruments, are awakened when you are, you know, brought back into the reality of your life in God. And spontaneously, there is a new song. Okay, it's not a song that you can utter with your physical trumpet, with your physical mouth, because you remember these spirits sang this song. Even, you know, the spirits don't have bodies. We are talking of people who, these are sons of God who are in the spirit realm. You see, we're not talking of physical audible voices here. It's a song, inner song unto the Lord. Okay, when you have a new song unto the Lord, it's a ministration unto the name of the Lord. In that dimension, everybody sings unto the name of the Lord. Okay, and it's a song for the living. It says, everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Having breath is having the breath of life, having the Spirit of God. And if you walk by the Spirit of God, you are actually alive. It's only then that you can praise God. No man can praise God except by the Spirit. No man can call God except by the Spirit of God. Okay? So everything, this is the new song we are singing today. It's a ministration unto the name of the Lord. Okay? Can we now begin to, you know, recognize the Lord in the creation? Recognize our lives in the Lord and to live a dedicated life unto the Lord, because in reality there is no other life apart from the life of the God, of the Lord. Okay, to ascend up to that pinnacle of creation and to sing this song will mean a letting go of everything that you acquired in the abyss of darkness. Okay, everything that you acquired in the lower parts of the earth. Okay, you have to loosen yourself. Those things that entangle you in this world, our human beliefs, these things have become idols. Those things we treasure here in this physical world have become like idols, and these are the things that are preventing you from seeing, you know, that fountain of life, from experiencing your joy in the Lord. So by self-recognition, because before you were in this world, you had an identity. You have an identity that is unknown by the men of this age. You have an identity that is not black, that is not white, that is not male, that is not female. You have an identity that is not material, immaterial. Okay? And you have, every man has to lift himself into that state. Purify yourself from the knowledge of this age. This is what Jesus says. Those of you who are worthy have to leave all for my name's sake. Everything that we have ever learned unto ourselves in this world, we have to let it go and reconnect back to that one pure consciousness that was there in the beginning. That's how you sing the new song. If you go, let me quickly go to the book of Psalms. We're speaking about the new song. It's an inner ministration unto the Lord. Okay, and I'll tell you something. If you want to see the song of angels, if you want to see or hear the song of the Spirit, look into the creation. Everything that is created, everything that is seen or perceived in this world, okay, which men to date have received as parables, is actually a ministration unto the Lord. Everything is created praising and testifying of the Lord of glory. Everything in the creation. You know, I was just taking a walk this morning and I looked at different trees, I looked at different structures, landscape, and in the spirit I was just seeing the Lord in everything. I was seeing a song, okay, and this song was testifying of the Lord. That's why it says, sing a new song unto the Lord. It's everywhere. Everything is testifying of the Lord. Look at the trees, look at the branches, look at the leaves. Everything is testifying of God. It's testifying of the mystery. It's testifying of the mystical union that you have of the with the Lord. Okay? The branches are testifying of you. The trees are testifying of the body of the Lord. If you look at the birds that fly, look at the colors, you see the Lord in everything in the creation. Psalm 149, from the first verse, it says, praise ye the Lord, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord a new song, and his praise in the congregation of the saints. Okay, you can see that the praise of God is found in the congregation of the saints. You can't find the praise of the Lord, you know, outside anywhere, but only in the congregation of the saints. And the congregation of the saints, I've always told you, is nothing, it's not a church that you see on Sundays. It's not a gathering. You know, people build big churches and big temples on the earth here, and they call it the church of God. Look, it is not the church of God. Okay, the church of God, which is actually the congregation of the Almighty, is the body of God. It's a spiritual congregation in the heavens. Okay, whether you see the 144,000 standing upon Mount Zion are actually the church of God. It's a body, a celestial body of sons of God or angels. You can call them morning stars, they're all the same, that actually form the body of the Lord. It's the congregation of the Lord, the body of the Lord, the church of the firstborn. It's something in heaven, it's not upon the earth. So you see here, it speaks about praising the Lord in the congregation of the saints. Okay, this is a divine congregation. It's not something that is, you know, fashioned by men. Okay, it's not something that, you know, is known in this present world. Hallelujah. Let Israel rejoice in him that made him. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their king. Let them praise his name in dance. Oh, hallelujah. Let them sing praise unto him with timbrel and harp. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Oh, hallelujah. Now let's pause there. You can read the rest later. But I just want us to see here that, you know, we praise the name. Now notice, the people who stand in this congregation actually have the name of the Lord. Okay? And I've always said it, that if you really truly want to like praise God, if you truly want to like worship God, you worship God by abiding in that name, by living according to that name, by walking in him. If you do this spontaneously, you are already giving praise to the Lord. You are already glorifying his name. Oh, hallelujah. When Jesus says, Father, I have glorified your name, he has glorified his name because he walked faithfully in relation to that name. This is what we are called to do today. And it comes by recognition, remembrance. When God spoke to Job out of the whirlwind, the same way God is speaking to every man out there today, God was bringing remembrance. Where were you? You ask yourself, where were you when the morning stars, you know, sang together? Where were you when the sons of joy, the sons of God, you know, shouted for joy in the beginning? Where were you? Where were you? Ask yourself that question. Relocate yourself by remembering yourself among God's congregation of saints. and spontaneously walk in that light. When we know these things, you know, it makes things easier. Self-recognition, you shall know the truth about yourself, and the truth will liberate you from all the sinful sensations, you know, all your sensation of being separate from God, being a sinner, your imperfections. It will liberate you and set you free and catapult you into the glorious liberty of the sons of God. Now, these sons of God are the same sons of God that stand upon Mount Zion singing a new song. They are the same sons of God that God mentions out of the whirlwind. God mentions to Job that have been there from the beginning in God. Jesus says, "You have been with me from the foundation of the world." He was referring to those people, those angels, those ministers, those sons of God who were in him before time. Okay? So the disciple is the one who has exercised himself to hear. He has heard this thing. He has heard of the Lord, and he has exercised himself to walk in truth. Praise God. And he now begins to experience this new dimension of bliss. He sings a new song before God unto all eternity. Okay? A song that no man on the earth can learn. As long as you are a man, you can't sing this song. Okay? The songs that we sing as men are songs and praise unto idols and gods that cannot see, that cannot hear, cannot smell, cannot taste. But the songs of men are dead songs, songs and praises unto the dead. Okay, but if you begin to hear, you begin to now, you know, sing a song unto the Lord. Your eyes are open to see God in the creation. Okay, you now stand consciously before his throne. Okay, you stand in him and you see God in all things. Hallelujah. He's the one in the midst of all things. Keep still and see the Lord and sing this new song today. God keep you, brethren.